The Feraligatr line is my favorite starter line of any generation, mainly because I was using it to speedrun Gen 2 before I even really understood what speedrunning or challenge runs were, where you just teach Feraligatr Ice Punch, Surf, and Bite, and you can solo the entire game with it. So of course I enjoy Feraligatr's rich TCG history. Even though only about 14 Feraligatr cards have been printed, there's just so many iconic decks that stand out with Feraligatr that it's hard to ignore. Especially when compared to Meganium and Typhlosion, which if you've watched my two previous TCG history videos, you know that they don't stack up anywhere near the way Feraligatr was played. So let's get started taking a look at all of the Feraligatr cards that have been printed up until this point and judge them based on how pretty they are, how playable they are, and if they're just interesting or not. Starting with Feraligatr's debut in Neo Genesis. As you probably know, there were two Feraligatrs in Neo Genesis, but we'll start with the Berserk one. For this Gator, we will completely ignore Chomp as it is an unreasonable attack to use for 4 water energy. But the focus of this card isn't really in its attacking power, it's in its ability, Berserk, which allows you to flip a coin when you evolve up into Feraligatr. If that coin flip is heads, you discard the top 5 cards from your opponent's deck, and if it's tails, you discard the top 5 cards of your deck. A very risky move, unless you have built an entire deck around ensuring that you are able to shuffle your deck and recycle cards more than your opponent, and just hope that you hit more heads than tails, which is exactly how this card was used in more of a rogue deck. It didn't see a ton of tournament play, but Berserk was definitely an archetype. In conjunction with Hyper Devolution Spray and cards like Scoop Up and Super Scoop Up, you could devolve and re-evolve into Feraligatr multiple times utilizing Berserk, hopefully hitting more heads than tails, and decking your opponent out, milling down their deck, while you on the other hand don't have to worry about attaching energy at all, just evolving up into Gators and playing the right trainers like Telm Volunteers to make sure that you don't deck out from all the tails you hit on those coin flips. While not terribly consistent, it is terribly fun to play, so I'd recommend checking it out. And then there's Riptide Feraligatr, definitely the more iconic of the two, because it was the defining card of the Rocket On format. It had such amazing synergy with the trainer cards of that format that it dominated the competitive scene, and there weren't a whole lot of checks or counters you can include in other decks to really deal with this thing. So let's start with Riptide. It does 10 damage plus 10 more damage times the number of water energy in your discard pile. And then once you've calculated damage and dealt that damage, you shuffle all the water energy cards in your discard back into your deck. Feraligatr's Downpour Pokemon power assists in racking up that damage because it gives you the ability to discard a water energy from your hand before you attack. And normally this card would be balanced out because all of those water energy get shuffled right back into your deck, but Trash Exchange existed, which would allow you to swap the remaining cards in your discard pile with a bunch of cards from your deck, which is full of water energy. So that gives you an opportunity to get a lot more water energy in there than normal. And then you also had Misty's Wrath, which would let you look at the top 7 cards of your deck, choose 2 of them, and throw away the rest of the discard. So you could essentially play Misty's Wrath, take 2 non-water energy cards, put them into your hand, and toss up to 5 more into your discard, thus powering up Riptide even more after you've used Downpour to already chuck a water energy in there. So on turn 3, when you attach enough energy to use Riptide, you're actually able to pull off a combo that's dealing 80 to 100 damage, and there's nothing in Rocket On that can withstand that much damage on turn 3 other than probably another Feraligatr. This combo in particular led to a very uneven, unfair, unfun metagame, so a lot of people just waited out the format until the gym sets rotated into Neo On. Now, Riptide Feraligatr did still see some play in Neo On, but because this combo didn't exist anymore, it wasn't as streamlined, it wasn't as fast or powerful, but if you were unprepared, Riptide could still hit like a truck. Because no matter the format, you're going to have means of discarding from your hand or from your deck, adding on to the synergy between Downpour and Riptide, making this card viable even without the extra help from supporters and trainer cards. With Neo Destiny, we got Dark Feraligatr, and Feraligatr found itself once again at the center of the metagame. When 99% of the decks in format relied on Cleffa's Eek attack in order to get their consistent setup, Scare was very scary because it kept that Cleffa from using Eek at all. Not to mention all of the other various uses that baby Pokemon offered, like Pichu, Magby, and Igglybuff. The inclusion of Dark Feraligatr in more and more decks meant that decks used less and less babies to minimize the damage it was actually doing, which was a bit of a godsend, honestly. In the expanded base Neo format, Dark Feraligatr made an amazing partner with Dark Vileplume to create the Gator Lock deck, and in Neo on, it paired very well with pretty much any other Pokemon that had Dark in its name. That way you could utilize Boss's Way and Rocket's Hideout for them both. It was paired a lot with Dark Crobat to make a heavy anti-baby deck, but when I use it, I like to use it with Dark Octillery. That way it's just got a little more feasible attacking option, and it's a card that's not used a whole lot and isn't really expected by your opponent. Due to these scare baby shenanigans, Dark Feraligatr was a major player at the 2002 World Championships. Keep in mind, during this format, Slowking had yet to be errated, so it worked with Dark Feraligatr very well to lock up your opponent. Because of this, it got 1st and 8th place in the seniors division and took 3rd place for juniors. And the only reason it didn't dominate like its predecessor, the Neo Genesis Feraligatr, was because that it couldn't efficiently deal a ton of damage. It would take a while to work up to a crushing blow, and by that time there were faster decks that could deal more damage, like your Baby Porters or your Kingdra decks. But all in all, at this point, you were either a competitive player that hated Feraligatr, or you loved it. Expedition had a couple of Feraligatrs in it, one of which being this ugly one here. It's a very simple card with not a whole lot of potential, honestly, as opposed to its Expedition e-reader counterpart, which has outstanding artwork, maybe my favorite of all Feraligatr artworks. Higher HP, a Pokepower in Major Tsunami that basically gives you a free Double Gust, making its retreat cost of 3 not really a factor. Rending Jaws does have a high energy cost, but it does have a little room for creativity in that if your opponent already has at least one damage counter on them, the attack will deal 70 damage. So, you know, you get a little creative in how you get that damage counter on there. That way you're not wasting 4 energy on only 40 damage. As far as the overall metagame goes, this Feraligatr didn't really have a place in it. It's much more viable in an e-reader only format, which is a bit of a custom format. But I do plan to explore the hell out of playing this card once the channel does work its way up into that e-reader only format. In Unseen Forces, we got a Feraligatr with some artwork that made me question, how long has Feraligatr had 5 fingers? And it turns out it was always just in normal artwork. They're all stubbling in this one, and it's a little too human. Getting into that Digimon territory, I don't really like it. The card itself isn't all that great for a Stage 2 in the EX era. It's got decent bulk, and pull away could be useful up against certain decks, but overall, just more of a starter deck type Feraligatr. Thankfully, Unseen Forces also included a Feraligatr EX, which was even bulkier and even more powerful in its attacks. Tsunami is a great damage spread attack for only 2 energy, and it also has a little bit of synergy to set you up for a late game Sore Spot sweep. The main problems with this card are the high energy cost of Sore Spot. If it was 1 less, this card would have been much more usable. The EX cards that had that high of an energy cost never really lasted long enough to utilize it, and the fact that overpowering Fang does not apply to Pokemon EX, and in the EX era, if you're in competitive play, odds are you're up against another EX deck, and so overpowering Fang isn't gonna see a lot of utility. I do like this card, and you can build some decently fun decks out of this card, but I can't help be reminded of a time I went to a state championship. And when I sat down at the table for one of the rounds, a guy asked me what deck I was running. I said, a Flareon deck. And he laughed and said, I'm sorry, but you're gonna lose. I'm running Feraligatr EX. And then I proceeded to knock out 4 Totodiles in a row, and he scooped. Which just goes to show, if you're a 40-year-old man playing Pokemon against a high schooler, don't get too cocky. This Nyx for Alligator also has quite a bit of sentimental value for me because it is the card that got me back into the TCG. I had dropped off during the e-reader sets just because I didn't like the way the cards looked. The metagame had gotten weird and I was kind of just growing out of it, and I hadn't really delved into the TCG until Dragon Frontiers dropped. I was just walking by the TCG section at Walmart or Target or somewhere and saw that there was an electric type for Alligator as the main card of a starter deck, and this idea just kind of blew me away, and I've started falling in love with Pokemon again. Because of the Delta Species gimmick, I started backlogging sets, learning the metagame, and getting back into the competitive scene. Now, as for the card itself, like I said, it's a starter deck card, so it's not amazing by any means, but it does have some interesting effects on it with Battle Aura, which for a starter deck is very good. It's free plus powers for all your Delta Pokemon. Drag Off can be really annoying for your opponent, but it could also backfire on you if they're just loading up their bench with great attackers to knock out your Feraligatr with. But all in all, it's just an interesting looking card and did its job well because it sold me on that starter deck, and I left with a deck of Pokemon cards that day and basically fell right into their marketing scheme. The Mysterious Treasures Feraligatr found itself into some pretty fast, powerful rogue decks, as with Energy Cyclone, you could discard a ton of energy in a single turn and deal a lot of damage on turn two. All you had to do is have enough energy cards in your hand to choose the amount of damage you wanted to do in quantities of 20, which was pretty easy to do considering this was a very draw-heavy format. Pretty much every deck ran Claydol, Uxie, Roseanne's Research, Cynthia's Feelings, because you could get the cards you need quickly. Really, the main problem that this Feraligatr faced in playability was a little reminiscent of the late Neo era in that Kingdra was just better. It had an energy cyclone type attack of its own, but for free. A great additional attack for only one energy, the same amount of HP as Feraligatr, and a lower retreat cost. So if you wanted to run an energy efficient, water type, high damage output deck, you just ran Kingdra. There was really no reason to go with Feraligatr. Heart Gold Soul Silver provided a base for Feraligatr that really just wasn't good. Its energy costs were way too high for what it actually did, so it didn't really get a lot of play, but it did get reprinted in Call of Legends with some alternate artwork, so that's something. No, the real croco draw of this set was Feraligatr Prime, which basically looked at Blastoise and said, "I am the Rain Dancer now." This Rain Dance was a little more underpowered as compared to its Tortoise predecessor, but that doesn't mean it wasn't useful. With it, you could flood the board with water energy, make Hydro Crunch a viable attack since you can lay two energy per turn, basically, and stack tons of damage with it. And it comboed amazingly well with Lantern, as you could use Rain Dance to attach water energies to Lantern using its underwater dive power, and then deal massive damage with powerful Spark late game after you have laid down all of those water energy. The combo was so simple and easy to use, it's kind of needless to say that this was a go-to deck and saw a lot of competitive play. Phantom Forces, what can I say about this Feraligatr other than its attack costs are too high? This is a format where Evil Tall and Night March were destroying opposing decks for double colorless energies. So a stage 2 with attack costs of 3 and 4 is going nowhere, even if the attacks are pretty good. In Shining Legends, Feraligatr got bumped up to 160 HP, but are the attacks any better? No, not really, but at least the artwork's better. It's fun to look at. And then we top off this list with the Dragon Majesty Feraligatr, where the Pokemon Company just went, fuck it, reprint the one that everybody remembers. Upgraded for the current format, of course, so you got that 160 HP. Downpour is basically the same, but Riptide costs one less water energy and is dealing an additional 20 damage for every water energy in your discard instead of the original 10 from Neo Genesis. So if you were wanting a great single prize attacker, this reprinted Feraligatr was actually a pretty great way to go, as you can combine it with the Honey Gather ability of Ribombee to get an extra 2 energy into your hand, discard them with Downpour, and that's a guaranteed additional 40 damage right there. It's still not going to be matching the damage output of your EX and GX Pokemon, but it is nice to see a competitive return of Riptide. And that's where we're at with Feraligatr cards up until the time of me creating this video. If you have any more information about any Feraligatr cards I may have missed, or outstanding decks that come to mind when you think about these Feraligatr cards that I may have missed, please let me know down in the comments. Also, let me know what TCG history videos you would like to see in the future. As always, you can find my social media information in the description. Thanks for watching the videos. Sorry about the ads. See you next time.